Humans have always been curious, and we've always been driven to find explanations for the things around us. We like to understand the hows and whys of the world we live in. Exploring those questions has led us to all kinds of useful advances, like machines that wash our clothes, or the ability to predict whether it's going to rain before we leave the house. But what about the big questions? Questions like, what's the nature of the universe? How did it begin? And how will it end? According to Stephen Hawking, we may never find concrete answers, but we do have some pretty solid theories. When Stephen Hawking published his book, A Brief History of Time, in 1988, it sold so well that it remained on the Sunday Times bestseller list for almost 5 years straight. Before he wrote it, he was a famous academic. Now, he's a household name. Hawking sadly passed away in 2018. But his book is still a valuable go-to for those who ask the big questions. In it, he explains what scientists have discovered about the nature of the universe in a way that anyone can understand. In this video, we'll explain his answers to some of humanity's biggest questions. First, we'll explore the idea of the grand unified theory of everything. Then, we'll delve into general relativity, which describes the world visible to the naked eye. And finally, we'll explore quantum theory, which describes everything that's too small for us to see. We'll also touch on what it suggests about the beginning and the end of the universe. Before we can start talking about the nature of the universe, we need to take a quick look at how we talk about it. See, scientists like to describe the world in terms of theories, rather than concrete facts. They make observations and take measurements. Then they come up with equations that describe what they see and help them predict how things would behave. Every observation that supports a theory makes us more confident in it. But we'll never get conclusive proof because there's no way to know that we took every possibility into account. Even if a theory looks bulletproof, there's always a chance, even if it's just a small chance, that a future observation could prove it wrong. So scientists don't prove, they theorize. At the moment, there are two theories that get pretty close to accurately describing the behavior of most things. General relativity, which works really well for anything we can see with the naked eye, and quantum mechanics, which describes the tiny things that we can't see. And it raises a lot of very interesting questions. Those two theories still don't describe everything, though. There are many questions left unanswered. For example, is dark matter real? Will we ever find a wormhole? And could we actually use it to travel through time? The ultimate goal of science is to discover the grand unified theory. A series of equations that can accurately predict the behavior of anything in the universe. A theory of everything could still be a long way away. We might even have to invent a whole new type of math just to describe what's really going on. For now though, here's what we think we know. Let's start with the theory of general relativity, which does a pretty good job of describing the big stuff, everything we can see around us. First of all, what does relativity mean? In this context, relative means in comparison or relation to something else. You may enjoy yogurt, for example, but relative to your friend who loves yogurt and eats it for every meal, you're not exactly a yogurt head. What general relativity says is that when we measure something, we can only measure it relative to something else. For example, motion is relative. We can only tell if something's moving if it's moving relative to us. And we can only measure how fast something's going by comparing it to something else. Here's an example. If you're sitting in the grass watching a train go by, it's easy to say that the train is moving and you're not, because relative to you, the train's going pretty fast. But you actually are moving, because the whole planet is moving. It's rotating on its axis. It's orbiting around the sun. Even the whole solar system is orbiting the center of the galaxy. So if you measure the speed of that train, you're not measuring how fast it's really moving, just how much faster it's moving than you are. If you wanted to know how fast the train is actually moving, you'd have to compare it to an object that's not moving at all. The problem is, everything in the universe is moving all the time. So we can't do that. And that brings us to an interesting point. If there aren't any totally stationary objects in the universe, then even our measurements of space must be relative. In other words, we can only know where an object is in space relative to another object. For example, I can tell you that California is about 1,200 miles away from Kansas, but that's a relative measurement. Where's California actually located? I can't tell you, because I'd have to compare California's current location in the universe to the location of an object that never moves. And again, everything is always moving, so we'll never be able to pinpoint California's absolute location. Actually, what I find really interesting is that California's probably never been in the same place twice, but it gets weirder. Because if motion and space are relative, then time must be too. You may think that it passes the same for everyone, but it doesn't. When we compare how time passes for two different objects, we discover that the speed of time is relative to their motion. For example, a clock at the peak of a mountain will actually run a tiny bit faster than a clock at sea level. When the planet rotates, the mountaintop clock travels a greater distance and ends up a little ahead of the one at sea level. It travels through space more quickly, and as a result, it travels through time more quickly too, which honestly is just absolutely mind-blowing to me. I mean, seriously, like, it doesn't just happen to clocks either. The same principle applies to us. Compared to your feet, your head experiences accelerated time. Maybe that's why our heads get bald and our feet stay hairy. That's a joke. But it's true that the faster you move, relative to something else, the more your experience of time speeds up in comparison. And when you slow down, time does too. Albert Einstein is the one that discovered time works like this. It was one of his biggest contributions to science. But he didn't stop there. What really interested Einstein was the relationship between space and time. He theorized that space and time are inherently connected in what he calls the fabric of space-time. As objects move through space, they crumple and squeeze and pull at this fabric. And as they do so, they distort both space and time. The effect, according to Einstein's theory of general relativity, is what we call gravity. According to the theory of universal gravitation, all objects are attracted to each other by gravity. The strength of the pull is determined by two things, the mass of the object and the distance between them. The Earth is huge. It has lots of mass. So it has a strong gravitational pull. And that pull affects us much more strongly than, say, the moon, because we're closer. But that raises an interesting question. If every object pulls on every other object, shouldn't everything in the universe slam together in one big messy clump? The reason that doesn't happen is because the universe is constantly expanding. Everything in it is moving apart, and the speed of that outward movement is fast enough to overcome the inward pull of gravity. There's a similar back and forth dynamic inside of stars. A star is basically a huge fireball that's constantly exploding. The explosion creates an outward push that counters gravity's inward pull. Eventually, though, a star runs out of fuel and can no longer keep itself from collapsing. If the star is big enough, the gravitational force is so powerful that it collapses into a single point. That point is called a singularity, and its gravity is so dense that it's inescapable. Not even light, the fastest thing in the universe, can escape it. The current theory is that once enough stars collapse, and the universe is full of singularities, everything will clump together. It'll all crush down into one giant singularity. What Stephen Hawking said is that this might have also happened in reverse, that the universe started as one giant singularity, a black hole that became the Big Bang. Now, we used to believe that the universe was infinite and unchanging, that it was a perfect system, and that it always existed in its current state. But in 1821, German astronomer Heinrich Olbers pointed out that if this was really the case, the universe we see would look totally different. For one thing, our sky would be one endless blinding white light. That's because light expands outward as it moves. If the universe was infinitely old and infinitely large, we'd get light from every star in the universe, from every possible angle. But that's not the case. So most stars must be young enough that their light hasn't reached us yet. Thanks to Olbers' insight, we know that the universe must have a beginning. According to this theory, every particle in the universe used to be crammed down into a singularity. Then the singularity exploded, and particles were blasted all over space in less than a second. As they spread out, they slowed down and clumped into stars and planets. But they never stopped. We're all still drifting from that original explosion. And that's what prevents us from collapsing down into another singularity. For now. But was that really the beginning of the universe? Or did something happen before that? To answer that question, we have to study the tiny particles from the very beginning of the Big Bang. But there's a problem. Our math for the big stuff doesn't work for the little stuff. So far, we've explored the theory of general relativity, or the theory of the big stuff, and what it implies about our universe. But there's another theory of the universe that's incompatible with the math behind general relativity. It's called quantum theory, and it describes the behavior of the smallest particles we know to exist, the kinds of particles that would have existed in the first split second of the Big Bang. First, we need to talk about why general relativity doesn't work for tiny particles. Let's take a step back. General relativity uses math to predict outcomes. The math takes concrete numbers and delivers a concrete result. For example, we can look at the moon through a telescope, track its position, and derive an equation that describes how it moves. We can then use that equation to predict where the moon will be in the future. That's pretty cut and dry. All we need is a few measurements of the moon's position and speed. As long as we've got those numbers, the equation will give us a clear prediction. And if it's a really big object, like the moon, our measurements don't even have to be very precise to get a decently accurate answer. But when the particles we're looking at are extremely small, if our measurements are even a little off, our predictions fail. Let's take an electron, for example. We have to measure it in an indirect way because we can't see it. We do this by shining light at it and seeing how the light scatters. But when we do that, we disturb the particle we're trying to measure. We bump it and push it around, changing its speed. It's like a foosball table where the ball's invisible. You can wiggle your little guys around until you hit something, but once you do, there's no way to tell where it went. And it turns out the more accurately we want to measure a particle's position, the more we have to disturb it. So the better we understand a particle's position, the worse we understand its speed, and vice versa. This problem is called the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. It's the foundation of a lot of complicated math we call quantum theory. Quantum theory is governed by a totally different set of equations than general relativity. It predicts a range of possible outcomes based on a series of probabilities. Instead of describing an electron as a clear point moving along a line, it describes it as a cloud of possibilities. If it's around here, it could be moving like this, and that means it might behave in one of these ways. The data is different. We can't take accurate measurements of tiny particles like we can the moon, so the math has to change. One of the biggest goals of modern science is to find a way to unite quantum theory and general relativity. We haven't managed it yet, but if we do, it could lead us to the grand unified theory we've been searching for. Quantum theory has led to a lot of interesting ideas. For example, what if our universe isn't the only one that exists? When we represent the behavior of an electron as a series of probabilities, technically they all exist at the same time. When we take a measurement, some of those possibilities stop being possible. But until that moment, it was just as likely from our perspective that another possibility was true. Some scientists have extrapolated on this idea. Maybe particles don't just follow a single trajectory. Maybe they follow all of their possible trajectories. And we just live in a universe that resulted from one of them. Maybe there are other possible universes, just as real as this one, in which things went differently. Sure. We can't see or interact with them, but that doesn't mean that they're any less possible than ours. That sounds pretty weird. In fact, people have come up with all kinds of crazy ideas based on quantum theory, some of which are much less likely than others. But here's an interesting one Hawking presents in his book. What if space doesn't have a beginning or an end? What if there aren't any boundaries like that? Hawking says that it's possible for something to be finite without having boundaries. The Earth, for example, isn't infinite. But it doesn't have edges either. There's no beginning or end of a sphere. In the same way, it's possible for there to be a finite amount of space-time without having a beginning or an end. And maybe there's no forward or backward in time either. If that's the case, he says it doesn't matter if there's anything outside of our universe, or if anything existed before it. It doesn't even matter if it was made or how it came into being. None of those things are necessary. Quantum mechanics allows for the possibility that what is, just is. When Hawking suggested this, he was asked whether he thought the universe and our lives in it had meaning. Here's what he said. Remember to look up at the stars and not down at your feet. Try to make sense of what you see and wonder about what makes the universe exist. be curious. And however difficult life may seem, there's always something you can do and succeed at. In his book, Hawking says it may never practically matter to us whether the grand universal theory is ever discovered. Knowing how the universe will end doesn't really help anyone. After all, we won't be around when it happens. But the big questions are still being asked today by people of all ages, and that makes them worth exploring. This book has lots of great insight into the nature of the universe that we didn't have time to cover in today's video. If you're interested in going deeper, check out the Shortform Guide to A Brief History of Time. Shortform makes the world's best guides for nonfiction books. They're like book summaries on steroids. You can get a 5-day free trial and a discounted annual subscription if you go to shortform.com/YouTube. Click the link in the description below. And support the author and publisher by buying A Brief History of Time. A link to buy the book is below as well. And finally, hit that subscribe button so you don't miss the next Shortform video. Thanks so much for watching. See you next time.